this morning, you know, while I was also in Volkslist, but during the whole week, what I encountered again this week, you know, is man's understanding and man's position in his own heart and understanding to live in this sin consciousness and not son consciousness. You know, that sin and the definition of sin, we perhaps can sometime later elaborate more on that, but sin focus, you know, people are so living with a consciousness of what they're doing right and wrong, and allowing that to disqualify you or to prevent you, take away your liberty to step into that intimate relationship with God. And I found on and on and on during this week in so many conversations that although we are living in the light, we somehow embrace the old life, the old nature, and the old understanding of darkness to cloud our hearts, our minds, and our application value of the truth. I really just want to share the scripture with you guys. I'm just going to share two scriptures. Just for preparation for you guys, I'm going to read from Romans 6 from verse 4 to 11. And I'm also going to read Ephesians 5, 8 to 11. And I will refer then also to Hebrews 10. So Romans 6 from verse 4 says, therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in this newness of life. For if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we also should be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we also live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death that he died to sin once for all, but the life he lives to God. Likewise, you also reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And Ephesians 5 verse 8 to 11, he says, for you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness, righteousness, and truth, finding out what is acceptable to the Lord, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. And when I read these scriptures, I was just so overwhelmed by the fact that we allow our old nature, which was founded in Adam, now that we've been made alive in Christ Jesus, that the indoctrination, the experiences, our own foundation allows us not to embrace what God has actually provided and given for us in righteousness. And even if I go back to Romans, it's so obvious through the scripture, he says, as we died with him in his death, we now live with him in his resurrection. He dealt with sin, yet we do not fully apply that in our daily walk. There's a request that says, therefore walk now in the newness of life. Now my question is, what is the newness of life? We all know that we've been recreated in Christ Jesus. We are the workmanship of his hands. We are his beloved. We are his sons and his daughters. But now, when we live in this deprived environment where we do not fully enjoy the intimate relationship with God, because our understanding leaves room for the thing that we perceive as sin, which is deeds, which is not That's the fruit of sin. That's the fruit of darkness, to hijack our lives. You know, this morning I used that example in Leviticus where the family bring their lamb to the high priest for the offering. And we all know it should be a 12-month-old lamb, perfect, without spot, without blemish. And I asked the question, I said, who does the high priest inspect? Does he inspect the family head or the lamb? Who committed the sin? The family head. But who does he inspect? The lamb. Once he inspected the lamb and he finds it that it's worthy to be slain and killed on behalf of the sin of the family, he then lays his hand on his head, gives the family head the knife, and he can kill it. And once he killed it, he turns around, he walks away, and his sin is taken away for 1 year. It's covered in the Old Testament. Under the Old Covenant, it's covered atonement for 1 year. He walked away as a free man. In this life, there was a lamb slain for us who set us free once and for all, died the perfect offering for us, yet we live with this consciousness that it's not sufficient. By application, as Christ is now living a life of glory towards God, we should embrace the same truth and apply that in our lives. Because if we do not embrace the truth, it will set us up for a performance orientation where we would like and we would live to gain that reward, to gain God's honor and rewards. We will never ever find that it's enough, because we will for always embrace that value that we are not good enough. We are not worthy. We will be disqualified. We will have that slave and servant mentality. Where as we accepted Jesus, we found and received the adoption of sons and daughters, we should live in that new creation which he has given us. And I find, you know, in so many conversations, sitting with people, we will find, you know, these comments. You know, I'm not at the place where I'm supposed to be, but I'm working on it. You know, I don't feel worthy. I don't feel like a son. You know, I don't even pray. Because I believe, you know, that I should rather get my life in order, get all my ducks in a row, and then, you know, perhaps God will somehow bear with me. And I just hope, you know, that his grace is enough for me. You know, I'm so afraid that there will come a time that God will say, no, one too many. One too many sin, and you are disqualified. And if we listen, and I said, I'm always referring to this. Andries has got this saying, he says, too many voices. And I said it this morning at Volksrus. In this time of COVID, there's more than enough sermons and videos and preachers and video channels available. And my question is, what do you subject yourself to? You know, in a certain understanding, there's a lot of people that can relate to an angry God because of their past experiences. So if they are presented with an angry God, they say, oh yeah, that's God. Oh yeah, no, that's fine. Yet, if you look dearly and sincerely, allowing the Holy Spirit to lead you and to guide you through scripture, you will find that God is a merciful, gracious, loving, kind God, actually desiring to reveal the Father, which Jesus came to do. And in these different foundational truths, you can easily align yourself with a misrepresentation of who God is. And this is why I really believe that what the Lord is busy and what the Holy Spirit is working in our midst in these past few weeks, past few months, the past few years, is drawing us into the understanding and the revelation of who we became in Christ Jesus, how we are able to have this intimate relationship with Him, how that can impact our lives, and how that can play out into the kingdom. You know, there's so many platforms, and even in our midst, there's platforms where people are sincerely eager to do stuff in the kingdom. But the foundation of that thing is you need to earn the favor of God. We need to make a stand. There's comments like we need to become warriors. You know, just a little bit more than a year ago, my daughter, my son, and they said they want to engage in warfare. They want to be warriors. I said, a warrior for what? You know, is God big enough to defend Himself? Is His angel armies not sufficient for us? Is it not sufficient for the kingdom? Where's our focus? Where's our consciousness? Is our consciousness just focused on the negative, the insufficient, the least desirable? Or is it focused on the true nature and the character and the heart of the kingdom? Scripture teaches us the battle is the Lord, the victory is ours. Greater that is He that is in us than he that's in the world, you know. So although we're walking in the light, we embrace the values of darkness. And we think that if we then command light, it will be there. And now we always say, if you want to remove darkness, switch on the light. Now, the switch is Jesus. He came to deal with darkness. He says, we are the light of the world and the darkness will not overcome it. You know, God, Jesus built the church and the gates of hell will not overcome it. Yet, you know, we've got plan A, B, C, D, and E, how to increase the numbers in the church. We say, no. I believe that we are on the right path, and that is the value of relationships. The value of allowing input, being teachable, being humble, remaining in Christ, renew our minds, guard our hearts, and allow ourselves to be accountable, allow ourselves, position ourselves to receive input so that we can remain in truth. The moment we step into independence, the moment we step into isolation, we open ourselves up to be deceived, to be misled. I mean, I shared it with Andries, you know, we had the opportunity to sit down with two of our leaders in town. And what we commonly speak of as we are sons of God, sons and daughters of the Most High. We speak about the whole creation is expectantly longing for the revelation of the sons and daughters of the Most High. They sitting with the understanding of those guys in Pretoria that hijacked that Christ glory and they became now small little Christs. I just believe, you know, the Lord gave this young man this revelation. But because of isolation and independence, he had nobody to soundboard that truth. Now they hijacked it. He's doing us no favors. And we're staying in Bethel because their reference of what we're saying without relationship is impossible to counter. Sitting in discussions, having coffee with one another, building a relationship, gives the opportunity to eliminate these misunderstandings. And there's many, many other people in the kingdom that carries many other diverse terminology and definitions. And I said it often, you know, only when we sit down with people and we test their foundations, we test what they believe, we ask them these questions and say, tell me, what do you believe? Who and how do you see God? How do you see the Trinity? Who's the Holy Spirit? What does righteousness mean in application to you? Not the definition. How does that position you to bring you to a place where you know that you are in right standing with God, regardless of what you do, regardless of what you believe. The truth remains, He gave us the gift of righteousness to reconcile and reunite us in Christ, bringing us to the Father so that we can engage into a loving relationship. And spending time with the Father, He will in due time reveal His heart. He will reveal His plans, His intentions with you as a son or as a daughter. And that will position you in identity that will allow you not to run from Him, but to run towards Him. And if that is not happening, we are embracing a gospel that is not founded on the grace and the truth of who God is. And unfortunately, if we are real to one another and we sit down with one another, we can indicate and we can actually name certain big teachers. They are world-renowned people. Yet when you listen carefully, you will find that there's a thin line of performance. There's a thin line of disqualification. There's a thin line of performance orientation to control people and to release works, which is actually dead works, to make people think they can earn favor and honor with God. I said it this morning. I said, if God is pleased with Jesus, who is blameless, who is without spot, without blemish, and He is holy, and we are in Jesus, then we are reckoned the same. And there's something you really need to listen and take time and position yourself in that understanding. But it doesn't eliminate that that's the truth. You need to go and we need to embrace that truth and make that your truth. It should become your foundation. That should become your understanding. That should become your desire to engage and seek the truth with Him. Not necessarily allowing other people to influence what you believe. No, just blindly follow. And we often say, listen, you don't need to believe us. And I know within the relationships, we know that we have the freedom and the liberty to speak out certain things. Yet we find ourselves that in certain things, we would rather discuss that in private with one another until we are fully persuaded and convinced that that is the truth. And that is the wonderful thing where I just sense that this morning, even in Volksrus, you know, it's more than 3 years ago. It's almost 4 years ago when we last drove there and shared the word there. There's a lot of time that's gone past, but the hearts and the spirit and the environment, the atmosphere was still inviting because the foundation is laid in relationship. The core value in Victory Life, whether it's Kriel, Bethel, or Volksrus, is founded in this truth that we say, before we build the church, let's rather build relationships. Because relationships sustain us outside church walls. And this is where I believe a lot of people missed it. And I said it this morning. People are looking for membership and not fellowship. They're looking for membership and no relationship. And it's impossible because the whole gospel is based on the relationship. It starts with the relationship between Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It started off in heaven with the Father, the Spirit, and the Word. And the Word became flesh. And because He became flesh, He set the standard and a platform for a new type of relationship. And then He died and He rose. And He set a new standard. A new dimension of relationship, which is infallible. It's it's sometimes for me difficult to perceive and to understand that he didn't just want to walk with me. He wanted me to be in him so that wherever he walks, I walk. And wherever I walk, he walks. In a sense, the church perceived this thing that when they make mistakes, when they lose their temper, when they smoke. I heard a sermon many, many years ago where he says, you'd rather not walk into a bar because Jesus will not go in there. He will wait at the door. Now, if that is, if you leave any room in your understanding that that is who God is, then I say, listen, there's a problem. Because my salvation and my kingdom life, because of my salvation, he is working with me and in me for a better quality of kingdom life. And he said he will never leave me, never forsake me. In the most darkest place, he will be the light. He is the light. And if we can embrace through righteousness, which he has done through righteousness, to position us for this kingdom life. And in Romans 14, he says, this is kingdom life. He says that you will find righteousness. This will bring peace and it will release joy in your life. That we will embrace this peace that he says, we are now in right standing with one another. And as we said this morning on our way back, you know, sometimes we just need to trust the character of God. Because religion do not embrace that. They pursue control and somehow certain levels of manipulation. But kingdom life is rooted in the love of God, trusting God's love for people, trusting his love that says his love covers a multitude of sins. His love does not keep score. His love knows no end. He will never give up. And even if this message might be labeled as cheap grace, I said it this morning, you know what Jesus did on the cross was not cheap. He allowed his whole body not just to be bruised, but he was unrecognizable, damaged, ripped apart as a sign of love to allow us into a relationship with him. And we cannot deny the work he done. And if people perceive it as cheap grace, then I say, listen, let's give it time. Let's see how this thing plays out, because if people know that they are loved and that there's a level of peace and that there's approachability towards God, they will position themselves there. Instead of imposing fear into people, making them have a sense that they will never ever come there. You know, that perfection that is released in the religion that says you need to become something. Instead of making known to them what has happened to them, who they became, and how God positioned themselves. You know, we spoke about it on Friday morning in the men's gathering. You know, the most important thing that we can position people is, don't worry what you do right or wrong. Just come home. Just come in the Father's house and allow him to love you, and he will sort you out. He will make known to you in the various ways that only God can do that. You know, we said it in Tuesday's meeting. If God can allow a fish to spit out a coin to reveal to people who he really is, if he can make a donkey speak, what is the limit? My question is, you know, how much of these things are we still embracing? How much of these things are we still trusting God for his character and his heart to accommodate is the weaknesses and the fall and the state of mankind. Because we are on this earth. So instead of trying to create good morality and good people and good Christians, our approach is, say, listen, man, just allow him to love you. Fall in love with Jesus. Get to know the heart and the character of the Father. Get to know the voice in intimacy. Get to know the small, still voice. Become familiar with the dreams and visions. Allow the kingdom, allow the body to love you. This is one of the challenges because of this thing. People do not want to get to, they don't want you to get to know them. Although they know God knows everything, there's still this small little voice that says, I hope not. For ek hoop tog net nie hy onthou daai ding nie. The fact is, he doesn't remember it. He knows me as a creation. He's not interested in my sin. He dealt with it. He's removed it as far as the east is from the west. He's put it in the depths of the sea. Yet my consciousness is those things that might just disqualify me. And he says, well, I knew that's going to happen, so I dealt with it. So get that out of the way, and then we can focus on our relationship. Come home, son. Come home, daughter. Let me father you. And I said it this morning as well, you know, our challenge is society has created an image of the father, of a father, that makes it difficult for us to release this message. And we also find that we more than ever need to trust the power and the glory of the Holy Spirit, who says, I will do that. I came to save, not judge. I redeemed you. I paid the price. So that whatever is you perceive as a hindrance, whatever you perceive as a stumbling block, I can deal with it. And I have dealt with many of those things. You know that definition of the metamorphosis from the worm to the butterfly. I'm fully persuaded and I'm fully convinced that the more people realize they are butterflies, the more encouraged they become to live in this new identity and start pursuing this relationship with God. I had two meetings in the past week with young people. People that normally would be labeled for staying together, having a buite-egtelike kind, and all hierdie type van goed. And how that influenced them. And how that positioned them in isolation because of shame and guilt. And Andries, you also shared it in that video. I mean, you said that you made that comment of the people that we marry. You know, how many of them stay together? In February, I was presented with a situation where a dominee said to a couple, they cannot get married about 10 days before they got married. Because he got notice of how things plays out. And he just said, listen, we cannot marry you. And how that created an opportunity for us to come with grace and mercy, the heart and the character of the Father, present that. And that has now released the knowledge and the experience they received from this is aligning them. And for the first time ever, the gospel makes sense to them. And now they say, how can we get involved? What time does church start? I just sense, you know, when the Spirit of God becomes real to you, when the heart of the and the character of the Father and the Son has been revealed to you, it's very difficult. It's like what happened to Paul. He says, it's very difficult to kick against the goats. It's possible, but it's difficult. Unless they position themselves and continuously now being exposed to this. And this is what he says. You know, we are here to expose darkness. The impact of what religion and the misapplication of the law, the new wine and the old wine and the old wineskins. The effect of that thing, we need to expose it. And not criticizing, but presenting the truth in love. Revealing the heart and the character of God without entering into arguments and reasonings. I mean, this is that thing that we said at the meeting Friday. It says, the blind man, although they asked him many questions concerning religion and Jesus, he says, listen, of those things, I know nothing. All I know is, this morning I was blind, now I can see. And I believe, you know, this is the stand and this is the approach we need to take in the near future, where we say, listen, they can label us the same as Jesus, sinners, friends. You know, hate many drunkards gemeng, it's fine. You know, he set the prostitutes free. I said, that's fine. It's fine. In doing that, I would really like for people to get to know and to experience which we received for free. By His grace and His mercy and His love, what we have is what we received from Him. Yes, there is a level of accountability and there is a level of commitment and dedication. Yes, it is. But the reality is, it wasn't enforced. It came from the heart. It was voluntary. We surrendered because we experience that He is a safe place. My desire is that people will get to know God as a true, dear, loving, gracious, merciful Father. And Jesus is the precise expression of that, to help us, engage us, and the Holy Spirit lead and reveal this.